Hi, everybody. Today we're going to be looking at some of the causes of major depressive disorder. Now, this is an incredibly complicated topic, and there is no way we can look at every possible variable that plays a role in causing depression. But I do want to highlight a number of them because this is such a great example of how complicated psychological disorders can be. This is a graphic that you have seen many times before in class. It's simple, but it's a good reminder of how we can never fully understand human behavior without accounting for all three types of influences: biological, psychological, and social and cultural. Now, all of the causes of depression that I'm about to show you are ones that are supported by empirical evidence. However, it's critical to keep in mind that not all of these causes will apply to all people suffering from depression. In other words, we might have 20 different people with depression, and they could each show the same symptoms, but for a different reason or combination of reasons. But since we have to start somewhere, we're going to start with psychological and personal causes. Many people often first think about life events, such as getting a divorce or losing a loved one. And those can absolutely be risk factors for depression or make it worse. But it's important to remember that for most people, a life event like this may be incredibly stressful, but won't trigger major depression. The next potential cause we can look at is lack of social support. Certainly, we know that people are much more likely to experience depression if they feel lonely. In addition to this, people are more likely to experience depression if they feel that the future is hopeless. And finally, in this column, we have rumination, which is the tendency to dwell excessively on previous failures or unpleasant events. With many of these causes, we need to keep in mind that correlation doesn't necessarily mean causation. In other words, these can sometimes be chicken and egg questions. Does lack of social support cause depression? Or does depression lead to lack of social support because people are less likely to initiate social contact or because their friends no longer want to spend as much time with them? Does depression cause hopelessness or does hopelessness lead to depression? In reality, the true answer is probably a combination of both. Next, we can look at biological causes of depression. Certainly, we know that depression does run in families, so there is definitely the potential for genetic risk. In addition, we know that depression is associated with irregular levels of various neurotransmitters in the brain. But even here, it's not so simple because different neurotransmitters may be affected differently for different people. Last, we have toxic stress, which occurs when a person is consistently exposed to very high levels of stress that they can't control. It can have very long-term effects, including, but not limited to, an increased risk of depression. Finally, we need to look at social and cultural variables that are associated with a higher risk of depression. The first one is poverty. A lack of money won't cause depression by itself, but it's certainly going to increase a person's stress levels, as well as making it more difficult for them to seek treatment when they do experience symptoms. The second variable I want to look at is discrimination. It shouldn't surprise anyone that this will make it harder for people to obtain social support, to feel hopeful about the future, or to be treated with respect by healthcare providers. Next up is gender. Women are more likely than men to experience depression, and also more likely to be diagnosed when they do experience depression. There are all sorts of reasons for this. One is the case of postpartum depression, depression associated with pregnancy, which obviously affects primarily women. But in addition to this, we also know that women are more likely to be victims of intimate crimes, such as rape, which increases the odds of depression. They are also more likely to actually receive a diagnosis, in part because women are generally socialized to be more willing to seek help. The last variable I want to look at is LGBTQ status. Being gay or trans by itself is not a cause of depression, but discrimination and violence are risk factors, and they are more commonly experienced by gay and trans individuals. For example, we can look at the fact that in most U.S. states, people can be legally fired, evicted, or denied services because of their gender identity or sexual orientation. So it shouldn't surprise anyone that it would be incredibly stressful for someone to have to constantly work to conceal it. And we know that laws matter. For example, a 2017 study looked at data from over 762,000 teenagers collected between 1999 and 2015. The researchers found that in any given state, whatever year same-sex marriage became legal, there was a drop in the adolescent suicide rate the following year, and this drop was accounted for almost entirely by LGBT individuals. Now, these were high school students, so presumably they weren't planning on getting married right away. But just knowing that it was legal, having that official stamp of approval, was enough to make a difference. This brings us back to our list of possible causes. Again, the key here is to remember that all of these are related to increased risk of depression, but there can be multiple causes with different combinations for different people.